So in the last lecture, we had seen the formation of membranous labyrinth that consists of the utricle, the saccule, and utricle is connected with the semicircular canals and saccule is connected with the cochlea. And both of these are interconnected, and then this connection extends to form the endolymphatic duct and endolymphatic sac. Now the mesenchyme around it will proliferate and condense to form the cartilaginous aortic capsule. Now small spaces will arise within the aortic capsule and they will confluence to form the bony labyrinth. So this is the bony labyrinth, which is basically interconnected network of spaces, and these network of spaces, these are surrounded by the aortic capsule and they are filled with the perilymph. Now the structures are named in a very similar fashion when it comes to the bony labyrinth, except the one difference. Let me tell you here. So here is this is of course membranous labyrinth of cochlea, and around this is the perilymphatic spaces of cochlea, which is also called bony labyrinth of cochlea. So naming scheme here is the same, both are cochlea. Now here the difference is that if we come to this part here, there is no subdivision here. So here you can see this is the utricle and this is the saccule, but when it comes to the perilymphatic spaces, when it comes to the bony labyrinth, this is a continuous sac here, and this continuous sac, which is harboring both the utricle as well as the saccule, this continuous sac, a relatively larger sac, it is called vestibule. So this is the vestibule. So you must have a clear concept that what is the vestibule, and vestibule, it consists of utricle as well as the saccule, and then of course here are the semicircular canals, and don't forget that there are these dilated part of semicircular canals, which is called the ampulla of semicircular canals. Now this is the 3D model, and here we have removed the parietal bone, and here you can see that inside the temporal bone, the petrous part of temporal bone, here you can just see the endolymphatic sac. Of course the other parts of the internal ear, they are inside the petrous part of temporal bone. To understand it better, we will make it slightly translucent to see what is inside. So here we have made the petrous part of temporal bone slightly translucent, and here you can see that the membranous labyrinth is sitting inside the petrous part of temporal bone. Here is the saccule utricle connected with the semicircular canals, and this is the endolymphatic duct. Now what will happen, that around this mesenchyme will form, and around this, the surrounding mesenchyme will form the aortic capsule. Here I have made it slightly translucent. Here you can see this is the aortic capsule surrounding it. Now what will happen, that near the cochlea, here is the cochlea, near the base of cochlea, what will happen, that another extension of perilymphatic space, another extension of bony labyrinth will come out through this hole inside the temporal bone. And here you can see, not this hole, this one, the smaller one, this is the cochlea, this is called cochlear aqueduct. So it will come out, and here it will open up into the subarachnoid space. Subarachnoid space I will explain you with a 3D model, but please understand that subarachnoid space is deeper to the arachnoid matter of the meninges. So subarachnoid space is basically containing the CSF. So we can say that the bony labyrinth is connected with the CSF space, the subarachnoid space, and it is continuous with the CSF, cerebrospinal fluid. Now similar to the endolymphatic duct and endolymphatic sac, which are involved in maintaining the pressure and volume of endolymphatic fluid, The perilymphatic duct, it is also said to be involved in maintaining the pressure and volume of perilymphatic fluid. It is directly continuous with the cerebrospinal fluid. So if extra perilymphatic fluid is produced by the ear, it goes with the cerebrospinal fluid, and some cerebrospinal fluid may come into the perilymphatic space to equalize the volume or pressure as per the needs. So this was about the perilymphatic duct. Now let me tell you where it opens. As I've told you, it opens in the subarachnoid space. So let me exactly show you that. So here you can see the perilymphatic duct. So this is the perilymphatic duct. Of course, it is coming from the internal ear near the base of cochlea. And these are the meningeal layers. This is the dura mater. Meningeal layers, dura mater. This is the arachnoid mater, and the deepest one is the pia mater. And between arachnoid and pia mater, this space is called subarachnoid space, and it is filled with CSF, cerebrospinal fluid. Also, please understand that the dura mater, it is said that the perilymphatic duct, it is continuous with the dura mater. So basically, it is just an extension or sleeve of dura mater. Now the question, the most important question, the relevant question for this lecture is that what is the embryological origin of perilymphatic duct, how it arises? Unfortunately, there is not much data available in literature regarding the development of perilymphatic duct. The hypothesis is that it develops either from the extension of dura mater. So this is the dura mater, for example. So if dura mater was initially like this, it forms an extension like this. So one theory, one hypothesis is that it is formed by the extension of dura mater. The other theory, other hypothesis that I have also shown in the previous 3D model is that it forms as a result of extension of aortic capsule near the base of cochlea. So of course we have seen previously that near the base of cochlea, aortic capsule is surrounding it. So this aortic capsule, it extends outward and it gets connected with the dura mater and goes deeper into subarachnoid space to form the perilymphatic duct. So two possible hypotheses are there that I know of. Here is the membranous labyrinth, and here I have removed a section of it. Let's suppose we have cut it from here, and we can see what is going on inside the membranous labyrinth. Now the problem here is that the membranous labyrinth right now is just an interconnected network of tubes and sacs. It cannot do much by itself. There is no sensory receptors, there is no sensory organs. So how the sensory receptors develop? That is the important point, and that is what we must discuss today. So let's talk about histogenesis of utricle and saccule specifically, and later of course we will discuss the histogenesis of sensory organs of the semicircular canals as well as the cochlea. So here we have cut it. So here what we will see that at the floor of utricle, the horizontal sensory organ will develop. Similarly, here if we talk about the saccule, at the medial wall of saccule, the vertical sensory organ will develop. And both of these are very similar in structure. Their orientation is different, that we will discuss later. The structure is very similar, and that organ is called macula. So let's talk about formation of macula. If we enlarge it like this, we will see that here we have first these epithelial supporting cells. So here the cells of the floor of utricle as well as saccule also, they will transform into the what we call as supporting cells. On the top of that, on the top of supporting cells, some of the cells will proliferate and they will differentiate into specialized cells. And let me show you, these are those cells, and these specialized cells, they harbor special hair-like cilia. So here you can see they are having that hair-like cilia in a particular order. So here you can see that actually the length of these hair cells or cilia, it gradually increases. So from here we have shortest cilia and it gradually start to increase like this, and here we have longest cilia. So these cilia containing cells or hair like cells, these are called hair cells. These are hair cells of the ear. So this is the structure of hair cells, and they are embedded within the supporting cells like this. Here you can see they are embedded into the supporting cells. I hope you can understand. Now the structure of these hair cells is relatively complicated. To understand its physiology, I will make a simplified structure here. I will show you a more simplified structure that will help us in understanding the physiology later. The basic idea is same. We have just removed the other rows and we are just looking at the central row. Let me show you so you don't get confused. So here you can see there are many layers of these cells. So here we have many layers. For example, one layer is this, then we have this layer and so on. We have these layers. So I am just showing you, for example, this central layer like this. Rest of the situation is very similar. So here you can see, if we go forward, so this is the situation right now. So what we have seen, that there is the formation of supporting cells. Again, they arise from this epithelium of membranous labyrinth. So supporting cells, of course the hair cells, they also arise from the epithelium of the floor of membranous labyrinth of the utricle. Now what will happen, that from this epithelium, the hair cells and surrounding epithelium, special gel-like material will be released on top of that. Let me show you. So a specialized gel-like material will be formed on top of these hair cells, on top of the macula. It is covering the macula. So this gel-like material is formed, and another thing that happens, that these cells, and along with that, not only these cells, the surrounding cells, of course there are other cells in its vicinity. Let me show you. So there are these cells surrounding it here as well. So other cells, these cells as well as some other cells that are surrounding it, they will release calcium carbonate crystals and some proteins. So they will release calcium carbonate stones. Calcium carbonate stones will be released, and these, along with these calcium carbonate stones, some proteins will be released, and these proteins and calcium carbonate stones, they will intermix together to form special stone-like structures. They will form specialized stone-like structures. I should say they are actually stones, biological stones. And these stones, they will be lying at the top of, on the upper layer of the this gel-like structure. Let me tell you the name of this gel-like structure. But before that, let me tell you that these stones, these calcium carbonate crystals, are stones that are secreted by these epithelial cells of the floor of utricle and of the medial wall of saccule. These are called autoconia. Auto, O-T-O, auto. It's A, not A-U-T-O, it's, or they are also called otolith. Oto means something related with ear, and lith means stone. You might have heard of this term lith in regards to the kidney, the lithotripsy and kidney stones, you must be knowing. So these are not kidney stones, these are the ear stones, and these are not abnormal, these are normal and important biological stones. These are called otoliths or autoconia, and they are embedded in the top layer. They are actually sitting on the top of this membrane, this jelly-like membrane, and this jelly-like membrane is called otolith membrane. In reference to these otolithic stones, we call it otolithic membrane. Otolithic membrane. Actually, let me tell you something, that there is some controversy and discrepancy among the literature as well. some textbooks, they say that only this top layer of this gel-like membrane, only this top layer into which the onto which these autoconia or otoliths are sitting, only this one is called otolithic membrane or otolith membrane. Rest is just this gel-like material. But other books, they say whole of this jelly-like material, whole of this is otolithic membrane or otolith membrane. So this was the histology of macula of utricle. And now, what about the macula of saccule? Let me show you that. Let's enlarge the macula of saccule as well, which is on the medial wall of saccule. And if we enlarge it like this, we will see that its structure is very similar, almost the same. The only difference is that it is horizontally lying on the floor. In case of utricle, the macula is horizontally lying on the floor, but in case of saccule, it is oriented vertically. Macula is oriented vertically on the medial wall of the saccule. Rest of the structures is same, but here you can see that it is the autoconia, otoliths, and otolithic membrane. These are displaced slightly downward like this. This is due to effect of gravity. Actually, these stones, they are denser and heavier in weight as compared to this jelly-like material and other structures. So what they will do is that they will displace the autoconial membrane in response to gravity. So they are, in a sense, gravity sensors. This is very important for their functions. These stones are gravity sensors. They are affected by the effects of gravity. So because this person whose macula that we are looking, because he is on the earth, and earth, on the earth we have the gravity. So because of the effect of gravity, we are supposing that this person is sitting or standing with the head straight, vertically oriented. So that is why, due to effect of gravity, the saccule, the macula, this gel-like material, otolithic membrane, it is displaced downwards. Now, this is all I wanted to tell you about the histogenesis of utricle and saccule, of their macula. But I think this knowledge is not enough. You are seeing these structures are there and these are present here, but you do not know how they work. So I want you to briefly understand the physiology of this as well. We will not go into details of physiology in this lecture series, but in the upcoming part, we will also see that how these utricle and saccule, how do they work? We have this macula here, but we want to understand that how does it work. So in the upcoming part, we will see the basic physiology of utricle and saccule. Thank you so much for watching this video.